Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay. So today we have John here from FTI Consulting, and he's going to explain to us about his intake on steel rebars industry as well as consulting in general. So it's going to be a presentation and an interactive session. John is expecting lots of questions from us about his area of interest, today's topic of presentation, as well as consulting in general. So, I will just quickly go through this presentation. Most of us are aware of this. So, let us welcome John Scott, Managing Director, FTI Consulting.
Thank you. So thanks everyone. I'm John Scott. I'm a consultant with FTI Consulting. I'll go a little more into that in a few minutes. My topic today, and this is actually the first time I've done this, so it's kind of exciting. I'm actually also a recent Temple grad, 2015, with an economics degree, so I'm also very happy to be back. I sat in the same classroom on a handful of occasions. So this is what I call the rebar lesson or the rebar problem. And it's about what we as consultants can learn from the steel industry. There's some very very important lessons here as far as your approach to your market and your market share and your ratios and things like that. And I think it will be somewhat useful to consultants and to future consultants down the road. So I want to start out, a lot of this material about the steel industry is not mine, it's not original, it's been around for about 30 years. The credit goes to a Harvard professor by the name of Clayton Christensen. If you have not heard of him or you've not read this article or some of the related ones, I would strongly encourage you to take a look at it. This is the May 14th, 2012 volume of the New Yorker. Very, very interesting. It will give you an entirely new perspective on certain things about this as well. I'll give you a little bit of background about myself. I grew up in Doylestown, Bucks County, which is about 30 miles from here. In the mid-90s, I told my parents I was going to buy a bombed-out house in Fishtown. They thought I was crazy. That's kind of what the neighborhood looked like back then. That is now a casino. That turned out to be a pretty wise choice. Down here in maybe better light. In 2005, so I began my career as a computer programmer a little later in the 90s. In 2005, I joined FTI Consulting to assist with a very large pharmaceutical litigation that was based here in the Philadelphia and New York areas. It was in the news, went on for about 10 years, some of it's still going on. So a little bit about what we do, real quick. We have consultants in just about every industry: economic advising, business valuation, restructuring, litigation support, forensics, and so on. My particular role, I'm a litigation consultant. I'm not a lawyer in any way, but I do support on large litigation matters. Again, pharmaceutical matters, product liability matters, agency investigations like SEC or antitrust litigation, things like that. So I've been there for 13 years. It's very interesting work. On our webpage, of course, we have a list of the various areas that we do consulting in. So if you're interested, I suggest taking a look. The one thing I do have to say is some of the steel ideas I've got from Clayton Christensen, the ideas about consulting are my own and not my employer's. So. Getting back to steel, you all recognize this, the Golden Gate Bridge. For many, many years, it was the largest bridge in the world, largest span from the two posts. And if we go back about 80 years while it was being built, and we zoom in a little bit, on most of the old pictures, we see a banner right on each tower that says Bethlehem Steel. Bethlehem Steel contributed almost all of the steel that went into this bridge. This is back in the mid-30s. This steel went from Bethlehem down the railroad through Lansdale, out to Port Richmond, down the Delaware, through the Panama Canal, and then across the Pacific to, or up the Pacific to San Francisco. So Bethlehem Steel was at least the second largest steel company in the world at the time. Very, very important in terms of building out our infrastructure across the country. The only part of the bridge that didn't come from Bethlehem were the wires, and they came from Trenton, and that was the inspiration for this sign, if you've ever driven by it and seen it and wondered. And that's another steel company right outside of Trenton. That one's also closed. Okay, so in the steel industry, there are some tiers based on the amount of manufacturing that's involved and the type of raw materials. If we start at the bottom tier, we have rebar. Not very good steel. If you bend it a few times, it'll break. If you try to weld it, the welds will crack. It's just not very good. It's good for what it does, and that's about it. A little higher up the scale, we have bar steel, which you can use to make bolts or wire or bars. The bolt itself, like an automotive bolt like this, is at least four times stronger than the rebar in tension. Even though they're the same size, this one's four times the strength. It would also bend and then bend back and so on. And then I didn't bring any structural steel, it's kind of heavy. But at the top of the list is sheet steel. And sheet steel you can make into various shapes, like this channel. You can make it into ductwork, fenders for automobiles, things like that, refrigerators, washing machines, etc. So sheet steel, because of the difficulties in making such a an even sheet of steel that thickness, sheet steel has the highest margin of these types. And there's some other types of specialty types. So this margin kind of dictates how, the rebar you make at the very bottom, simplest process, but as you go up, the process gets more expensive, the materials get more expensive, and the margins get better. A little more on rebar. It's used in just about every concrete application. This is the parts of I-95 being reconstructed down in that storage room. Everywhere there's concrete, there's rebar, basically. The one thing about rebar is you can make it from just about any kind of steel. So you can make it out of scrap. You can make it out of other types of steel. If you had the patience and a blowtorch and a piece of the bolt or something, and a hammer, you could hammer this into a piece of rebar. You cannot go in the other direction, though. So if you have a lot of scrap steel, for a relatively small amount of manufacturing infrastructure, you can turn that into rebar. Back to the margins, what happened in the late 70s and early 80s was that the big steel companies saw these margins and saw the ease at which smaller companies could make things like rebar, and they started getting out of the business. So one by one, they just said, we're not gonna make rebar anymore. Soon after that, of course, they said, when we don't like 12%, we're not going to do that anymore. And, of course, you know how this goes. So the only thing they were interested in making was the highest margin steel. That didn't end well, because at some point, the manufacturers that had started at the bottom level were now interested in making the high margin steel. And along the way, we lost Bethlehem Steel. It's now a casino. and there are no longer any major steel manufacturers in the United States of that type anymore. So, this is an interesting question. How could the number, the world's number two steelmaker have been allowed to degenerate into this silent, decrepit Hulk? And what happened was, as we saw, they were chasing the highest margins. They left everything else alone and went straight for the high margins. That cut their market share down. It let the new entrants get a foothold, and ultimately it led to their demise. The one thing that Clayton Christensen points out here, though, is that they basically did everything by the book. They did not, when they were looking at the ratios, they looked at what products had the highest margins. And they said, well, these have the highest margins, so we should put as much of our time into them as possible. And that sounds right, that sounds logical. And yet it didn't work. In the consulting industry, the model is a little simpler. We really have two factors, the billable hours and then the billable rate. And you multiply them together, and that's your revenue, and then you subtract your fixed costs. The fixed costs are pretty standard. It's office space and benefits and salaries and things like that. So it's a fairly simple model compared to making steel. The rates in the consulting industry, just like steel, are also tiered. At the very top, we have expert testimony. That's usually the highest earning consulting. And you'll typically see rates over 500 an hour for recognized experts. I tend to group these as, you know, how far your recognition goes. If your recognition is industry-wide, you're going to be in the expert testimony category. If your recognition is with your clients, you know, your clients recognize you, they come back, you'll be in this middle tier, 200 to 500 an hour. And then if you're recognized maybe within your firm, you're in this processing tier. And I call it processing because in our industry, we do a lot of data processing and data manipulation. And most of the people that are doing that are not necessarily known to the outside world, but of course are very valuable to us inside the firm. And then we have other. I'll talk about other in a minute here. So, one thing that we hear frequently in our industry is this vendor down the street. Vendor in the consulting industry is kind of what we call each other. We call everybody except us. We're the consulting firm, they're just the vendor. So it's sort of a derogatory term. Sometimes you'll hear mom and pop shops, things like that, but most often we refer to them as the vendor down the street. And at some point in your consulting careers, you will probably hear something like this come up. The client comes to you and they say, the vendor down the street can do this for half as much and in half the time. And you look around and you say, well, you know, our staff is all fully utilized. Our rates are pretty good. You know, we have everybody busy on these higher rate projects. The rates on that project that they're bringing to us is very low. We may not, you know, we're not going to make a lot of money on it. And we're not really worried about losing the client because they're still giving us this higher up work. So we don't really have a lot to lose here, or do we? So what we say often is, yeah, okay, we understand, it's a fair price, we're really busy, we understand that, you know, they're in a better position to do this, and, you know, just let us know how we can assist you if we have to send the data over, bring the data back, whatever. So it's generally seems like a positive thing. We're not super concerned about losing this business here. But the question that you have to ask every time is whether that vendor tomorrow will be your competitor. And so there's a few other questions we'll get into, but basically, are we falling into the rebar trap? Are we saying, well, we don't want to do rebar, or we'll let the vendor down the street do the rebar, and we're gonna stick to the sheets deal, at the expense of our potential future, future market share. So, some of the things we're gonna consider each time are, was the client satisfied with the other vendor? If they weren't satisfied, not a big deal, then you're sort of third line of work. What are the vendor's ambitions? Does the vendor wanna be in that field, or is the vendor happy to be doing what they're currently doing? I'll give you an example. We do a lot of document processing, and in some cases there's still a lot of paper, and the paper has to be put in boxes and scanned, and then we get the electronic copies of the paper and we use them as part of the review. Do the people doing the scanning, do they want to do more than scanning, or are they better set up to do scanning, and that's that? So that second question, what are their ambitions? That's a pretty important question. The next one, are there barriers preventing the vendor from encroaching on your market? In the consulting industry, there are sort of relatively low barriers to entry for a lot of us. It does not require a law degree necessarily or a CPA license. On the other hand, it does require a good education. It also requires a firm with experience to do some of the bigger projects, and it of course requires staffing and the availability of that staffing. So there are some barriers, but are those barriers actually going to prevent this other vendor from coming into your market space? A few more questions. Will accepting the work at the lower rate thwart the competitor? Will that sort of shut them down? Will that interfere with their ability to get a foothold? If it does, then it may be worth it. If you want to keep them in their box, one of the ways to do that is to not let them take even the cheap work away from them. Same question, rephrased a little bit. Does this work help you protect your market share? If you do this work, does that help you? Is the type of work a gateway to higher value work? So if you are a scanning vendor, does that give you a leg up if the person says, hey, can you host that data after you scan it? Things like that. So you have to be careful. Once they have the data in their hands, for example, in a data-driven consulting industry, once they have the data, it's a lot easier for them to do other types of work with the data. Customers don't like to move the data around. It's expensive, it's time-consuming, sometimes error-prone. So we have to be careful about whether that type of work is a gateway to other types of work. Looks like the same slide. Let's go down. Okay, so this is where I'm gonna open it up a little bit. I'd like to talk about some possible strategies. Some of these are sort of being developed. I can also talk about some other industries that have tried some things. Some things have worked and some things have not. So I'll give you a few examples. The airline industry in the, 70s and 80s and 90s was being undercut by Southwest Airlines. And some of them decided that they would set up their own low-cost carriers and keep that sort of under their control. United did it with TED, Delta did it with Song, and then some of the European carriers did it with their own brands. The American ones are no longer around. They didn't survive. So that trick didn't work. But then there are other industries where it did work. Intel uses this, for example, when they built the Celeron processor as sort of a knockoff of the Pentium, it helped keep their share of the CPU market. So that's one strategy. You can set up your own low-cost group or low-cost team to keep the work under your control, but not necessarily under the same name. Some other strategies, of course, you could just do the work. You can take the loss on it. You can say, well, we know, it's not the kind of work that we want to do every day, But we wanna keep our market share, so we're gonna keep doing the work. So I'll put the question out there to you. What would you do in this situation? What would you do when you have a full schedule of $500 an hour work and somebody comes in and says, can we do this $200 an hour work? Or should I go down the street? Not become Bethlehem Consulting then, hopefully, right?
I would rather position myself in a position that would say what additional value is they are going to get because they are spending that additional amount. So rather than comparing myself with the other person or, as we said, the vendor down the street, so clearly, they are a small entity at present. Competition can emerge from that, but I am in a better position overall. So how the client can benefit from this position? The expertise, the other associated services, which the other person may not be in a position to offer.
Yeah, and that is certainly something that comes up quite often. If we talk about the scanning vendor.
So rather than reducing the rate, if I can offer some additional services.
Yeah. We would say, we'll do that.
At a discounted rate, maybe.
Right, yeah, we'll do that work because you might just need some other work from us further down the road with the same project. And so we'll try to bundle them in some cases. Knowing that if they don't do the other work, we didn't make a lot of money on this, but we will do it just to keep the possibility open, one-stop shopping.
Can you pre-negotiate that?
It depends. In consulting, it's not always clear the scope of the project at the beginning. In fact, it's almost never clear. It always starts out as, we have a small investigation we want to do, or we want to look in. We have this product that the NTSB is looking at, and we're a little nervous, that kind of thing. And then it hits the news, and then it's a big deal, and now you have a huge project. So you don't know at the beginning what you're dealing with necessarily. So if a customer comes in and they're at the lower tier of the product services, you don't know if they're going to come back a week later and say, oh boy, we actually need all of this. You can build it in, but it's there's some difficulties there because of the uncertainty at the beginning.
What type of
elicitation
do you use to kind of get to the bottom of that?
It depends. If it's a if it's a litigation, we know kind of how it might go. Certain types are different, though. If it's an antitrust litigation, the government does things pretty. Sort of a sequence, and we know exactly what's going to happen next. Most of the mergers, or a lot of the mergers of large companies, the government will take a second look at, and there's litigation involved just in convincing them that you were not setting up a monopoly. And this is fairly routine. They clear some of them. They don't. Some of them don't fight. So yeah, again, it's not, you can't always get that information at the beginning. And you have to build in the possibility that you'll be doing a lot more work down the road. Which I think to your point, can help you with the other competitors because they may not be able to continue the work. And we have, in my field, we have picked up projects that were started by smaller, smaller vendors that they were kind of out of their depth. Anybody else?
I think that would be like a team of inexperienced consultants, like people just getting their feet wet with like some experience to like oversee the project and let them take over to give them experience and show like that you're also interested in helping with small projects and companies, that you care about that as well as doing big projects while at the same time developing your team.
Yep, definitely. Your ability to delegate to junior staff on your team is definitely important in our, you know, in our industry. It means that you can take on more work, basically. And it's sometimes very difficult for people to sort of figure that out. So there's definitely something to be said for delegation. It definitely helps bring in more work. And you know, there's also something to be said for having enough of a junior team that you can do the whole spectrum of work at a reasonable cost.
Yeah. So you mentioned that like you have a full schedule of like $500 an hour work, right?
Well, I don't.
I'm like in this situation. So what about like hiring more people, because it seems like the demand is higher than your like supply of consultants?
So hiring is tricky because of there's a cycle and it's not always clear, you know, when it's going to be busy, when it's not going to be busy. You do have a lot of training overhead with hiring. You know, you bring people in, you want to keep them there, basically. So that, you know, that has proven to be difficult because in consulting, because don't always have a steady stream of work. One other point about the expert witness work, for example, the highest value work, you can't do that all the time. If you're an expert every day of the year, you know, doing expert witness work every day of the year, you're not really going to stay an expert very long. There's sort of this thing, this concept of a professional expert there. They lose touch with the ground level of their field. So you really can't do that work around the clock. And also there just isn't enough of it. There's less of that type of work than the main line consulting work.
Can I ask one
question? Yes.
For the development part of that, where do you see goodwill and future business development compared to the dollar aspect of the business?
So, I don't see them as different. I see them as basically the same thing. I think the problem is it's hard to put a dollar amount on the goodwill. So I see them as the same thing. And I think that was one of the explanation for the steel industry. That was one of the explanations there, that the ratios, the profit margin ratios, failed to account for goodwill. And it had a numerical value that was just not listed there. So the rebar was 7%, but the goodwill was maybe another 4% on top of that. And they just had not calculated that. And to this day, it's hard to calculate.
That's what I was trying to figure out.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you also have, you know, obviously the value of not having a competitor, and that's hard to factor in there as well. Your margins and your rates only stay a certain level while there's no competition or while there's minimal competition. And that's something that we fight every day. We have billing rates that are, we have to discount here and there because there's new entrants and there's competition. projects where there's gonna be, you know, it's a really long project, we'll have to discount it, of course. But there is always this push to get billing rates down, and that applies in my industry, it applies in the legal industry as well, with the law firms are, you know, more and more faced with flat fee arrangements. You know, where you can get a project price. And I actually have. In the legal industry, which functions a lot like the consulting industry, except it's, you know, it's a narrower skill set, you actually have partners making upwards of $2,000 an hour. That's at the upper end of the scale. The lower end, contract attorneys and contract paralegals are billed at $40 an hour or so, and then my group would call it, you know, the non-attorney consultants. But there is tremendous pressure on getting that $2,000 to not keep going higher, which it does. So there's, you know, the customer's pushing down and saying that we're not paying you $2,000 to copy papers. Anyone else?
Yeah. So in your previous slide, one of the questions that you were raising, you mentioned about competition, the side before that. Is this type of gateway work is a gateway for high value?
Yes.
So when they are considering this aspect, am I looking at will it gain a high value for contracts to the vendor down the street, or is it for my firm?
Well, it's both, and it depends on the work. But the question is, does the work that might go down the street, could that be part of a bigger project or a repeat project or something like that? So if you do that work, will that put you in a better position to do the second half of the project? And the same goes for the vendor down the street. If they get that work, are they gonna be able to use that to get to the second phase of the project? So we have to watch them both ways. If we let them take the work, they might get the related work. If we take the work, we might get the related work. So the question is, could they get the related work? Or are they sort of out of the running for that because maybe they don't have the size or the experience to do that second part? So that you know, whether it's a gateway to the next part of the project is very important.
We have also often seen nowadays that gig consulting or independent consulting is at a rate, it's increasing an exponential rate. So sometimes it is also seen that big firms are also having, they are outsourcing part of their work to such entrepreneurs. How does that figure out in this picture?
So that probably fits in very well because you are able to, the vendor down the street is your contractor basically. That's, you know, they're no longer that vendor, they're part of your firm. There are some flip sides of that. Some customers will say no 1099ers, for example. They'll give you the project, but they don't want you doing any 1099 work. They want everybody with the project to be covered under your firm and under the same agreement and so on. The other potential problem with that is that they are not exclusively working for you. They're working for everybody. So they sort of still are your competitors because, you know, your other competition gives them the work, they'll get it from them as well. So it's an interesting question. It's developing, but it's hard to say right now, you know, if that's how that factors into the market share. And then, of course, the other thing is if, you know, you can't have an independent contractor on indefinitely. The IRS rules, eventually you have to bring them into your firm as an employee, or they have to be set up as a corporation. So it's an interesting aspect, though. Okay. So I also, okay, let's call for it. I also mentioned that I would take general questions about consulting to the extent that I can here. Just the industry in general, unrelated to steel and consulting about steel and so on. Yeah.
So I'm a strategic communication major, and I'm curious about what you guys do specifically with Stricom.
Stricom. Okay, so some of these are going to be hard to answer, and that's one of them.
Oh, okay. All right. I do a lot of research, but I'm sort of see.
We had a Stratcom group in our office at one point. We no longer go there, and probably replaced it. And I, to be honest, I'm not fully versed in what they heard.
How did you end up in the field?
So I started out, as I mentioned, a computer programmer.
Mm-hmm.
I sort of got into that at an interesting time because the industry was sort of blowing up. The legacy programmers were all busy with Y2K, so that kind of kept them out of the way. And then websites were popping up all over the place. This was 97. So basically, if you had, you know, any kind of experience that they could use, they would hire you. So they would hire a lot of engineers that maybe were not programmers but knew enough about engineering to jump in. I had been doing it since I was 6 years old, so I walked right into it. And then I did that for a few years. That industry changed very quickly, though. While I was there, a lot of the programming was outsourced overseas. And you know, the Y2Kers came back, some of them retired. So it was no longer as straightforward to do that kind of work. Basically, to stay relevant in that, you had to get into some sort of client-facing aspect of it, or some management aspect of it, or you basically had to program 24 hours a day. So there's some folks that they're just into it all the time, and that's all they do, and they're very good at it. And then, you know, others are very good at managing teams. And then in my case, I liked interacting with the customer, the client, whether they were internal customers or external. And you know, that gave me a chance to do both the programming but interact with the end user at the same time. So I was sort of consulting on software back then, and then when the project in Philadelphia came up, it was sort of just a natural transition. I did, once I was at FTI, I did sort of shift away from data and programming towards litigation consulting, which has a very technical side of it. That's where that skill comes in. And we're literally dealing with tens of millions of for each project, and you know, even simple searches are very require a lot of thought and a lot of analysis. So
many of our club members are still exploring different careers, mm-hmm. and consulting is one of the options for them. So, what key inputs should they consider at this stage when they're looking at consulting as a career?
So, I guess it depends.
Well, in other words, consultant, what kind of competencies should they start building on if they want to look at it as an equity for you.
So, okay, so there's a couple of different areas. The, you know, if you, first of all, there's the licensed professionals, so the doctors, lawyers, and accountants. A lot of the expert witness work is going to go right to them because they're the only ones qualified. So they're in the consulting field, but they're sort of a little different from the rest of us. So if that, you know, obviously if that's your interest, you have to get a lot more education first. And we actually do hire quite a few lawyers, you know, maybe at entry level, you know, right out of law school. But a lot of people have decided that, you know, fighting traffic tickets for a living is not as interesting as, you know, some of the corporate litigation that we see. So if you're interested in some of that work, you have to get the advanced degrees. The rest of it, like the turnaround consulting, a lot of it is very heavy on economics, and again requires, you know, some advanced degrees, MBAs or PhDs. The other thing I would point out, the non-consulting experience that you get will be useful to a consulting career. You're going to look for experience doing things in an office environment with a lot of exposure to data and data handling and things like that, just the general office skills. One of the things we look at with entry-level consultants is kind of what they've been doing the last year or two prior to coming to us. There's maybe some trepidation about hiring right out of school. So the job before you become a consultant is going to be important. You know, maybe you don't want to be in certain industries that are not related to consulting, other than a short-term job or something like that. I've done plenty of them. I worked at UPS in 5 years even. It wasn't exactly short-term, but they definitely look at what you did prior to joining. So my programming was all with very large corporations that were either doing pharmaceutical work or publishing or something like that, and that certainly helped, you know, break into the consulting field.
Yeah. So we still have time for last question.
So that's a tricky question. I would just look for jobs that had, and they're not necessarily spelled out this way, but I would look for jobs that have similar aspects to them. Look for customer facing. It's absolutely required in consulting. No, not necessarily, but maybe sales in certain areas. Not rebar sales, for example. They're not auto parts sales, but sales of professional services certainly is helpful. But sales and something relevant that you can kind of connect to consulting. Because consultants, most of us are in some way selling at all times. My particular team, we have a business development department, so we don't necessarily go out and bang on doors. But most consultants at some point or another are responsible for, you know, bringing in additional work or bringing in new work. So the sales aspect of it is very, very important. And if you did have that sales experience ahead of time, that's certainly a way in. Struggling with what do we sell, but it would have to relate to Okay. All right, well, thank you, everyone. And good luck to all of you. Thank you.